Hey folks, here at osmvtxreviews.com. Today you're watching our video review slash video first look at the Epson Moveario BT100. These are a pair of transparent, see-through virtual reality glasses that are a blend between a traditional head-mounted display, such as a Sony HMZ or a Oculus Rift, and a mix between that and something like a Google Glass, which is transparent and not exactly, you know, meant for gaming or for performance or watching videos, but kind of like virtual reality in that you can still see the world around you, interact with it as content is being displayed in front of your eyes. So it kind of merges the two concepts into one thing, and for that, it's certainly innovative. The other interesting thing about the Epson Moveario is it has a Android counterpart already baked into it. Whereas other head-mounted displays require you to perhaps attach your device to a phone or to a computer to be able to be used, it's more like a pair of monitors. These devices actually already have an Android component built in. There's the processor, there's RAM, there's the programs, the system. So it's kind of like a smartphone where the actual display is the glasses instead of having a traditional screen, which is very interesting. The price of the Moverios are about $800. That's very expensive, I think, for a early adopter set, but it also makes a fair amount of sense considering you're getting both an Android-powered system and a pair of glasses in one. Now it's by Epson, so the company is behind making a lot of projectors. This product is made in Japan, just like the Sony HMZ series, so it is an import model, unfortunately, so it's not going to be found in stores like Best Buy. You have to find them online at Amazon.com or from Epson directly. It comes in this nice protective carrying case, very reminiscent of the MyView glasses that we reviewed a few years back. So we can unzip the device, and inside we have access to the instruction manuals right on top, and it says it's a quick start guide for telling you how to use the Android variant and the slight differences that that Epson has created on top of the guide, which is also presented quite nicely and printed in color instead of monochrome black and white. Tells you how to use the pair of glasses in an easy to use manner. And of course, we have access to the Android control set, which we'll talk about in a moment. There's the charger, the AC adapter in the US. There is the micro USB, which is actually used to charge the Android counterpart. And the Android counterpart also provides the battery for the unit, so it's actually quite important. And over here, we have the pair of glasses themselves with these shades attached. We'll also discuss that in a moment. And lastly, we have these removable nose pads of different sizes. And so they can provide a more comfortable fit depending on your nose size. And you can just stick them on the glasses. And also you have a pair of ear tips if you want to use those for the included earbuds. Of course, you can use your own pair of headphones if that's what you want to do. Now, coming back to the actual pair of glasses and the actual control set. The control set is kind of like the CPU of the device. In fact, it is the CPU. It provides the power, it provides the battery, it provides the processing unit. Inside, you have access to an ARM Cortex processor clocked at 1 GHz, along with 512 MB of RAM, 1 GB of ROM, and it comes included with a 4 GB SD card, so that expands the ROM to 5 gigs out of the box. You can expand that yourself by purchasing a larger micro SD card. So it's not the most powerful processor underneath the hood, but as with one processor units and above, it does the job for watching video, doing some web browsing, and doing some YouTube streaming. The device is not officially supported by Google, so you don't have access to the Google Play Store, and that means you can't install virtually any application you want to, although you can sideload them by installing on them on a flash drive and then putting them on here either via Bluetooth or some other function, perhaps using the USB cable. So it is doable if you want to install, you know, your own games and the such, but seeing that these glasses are mostly meant, I think, for video, for demonstrations, for virtual reality, to kind of view things rather than to play games on, because the control is going to be a bit awkward. Again, it's an interesting twist, but also a rational one from Epson. Epson has tweeted, kind of twisted the user interface on Android to make it more customizable and easier to use with a pair of glasses, and you can see that through the user manual here. Instead of going with a traditional Android interface, which you can still access, instead they went with a more circular icon here. So this is actually the main home screen that they've done, where you can just slide left and right between the various applications in a cycle view, and slide up and down to access more rows of applications. So the applications are larger and they're more easy to see, for example, gallery, music, and browser. So it's a more traditionalized, less customizable, but makes more sense for something that's controlled by a four-way navigation toggle and a D-pad. Otherwise, it's running on Android 2.3, so it's a bit outdated. But again, since you're not going to be doing anything too extreme on here, I guess you don't exactly need to do too much in terms of downloading apps. So it's okay for, you know, what it does. The actual device itself is crafted out of soft touch materials. It's pretty easy to hold in the hand. The trackpad part is actually quite large, so it is responsive. It doesn't support multi-touch, so you can only use one finger. There's an LED indicator to tell you when the product is turned on and off, and it will illuminate green when the actual device is powered on. So it's going to also illuminate yellow when it's starting to charge. Below that, we have access to the screen brightness changer, and also a back key, a menu key, a home key, a traditional 5-way D-pad if you don't want to use the optical trackpad, and also a 2D to 3D selection mode. The product supports side-by-side 3D, and you can see that by going to YouTube and then searching side-by-side, and there are hundreds and thousands of videos that have side-by-side formats. There's even movies, there's free ones, there's paid ones that you can watch on the device, and it works flawlessly. Simply hold on a 2D to 3D mode for about 2 seconds, and it automatically swaps back and forth between those modes. The bottom device features access to the micro USB for charging the product. There's also a proprietary port for connecting to glasses, and also a 3.5mm headphone jack if you want to use your own pair of speakers or earphones for that matter. The top features a power on and off switch, and essentially that's it. Again, these pair are made in Japan. The back features a proprietary connector for future accessories from Epson, including a dock which allows you to use HDMI input. So you don't have to use the Android device. You can actually plug in a computer or plug in another platform and use these as a traditional monitor screen instead of only going with these. So unfortunately, that's not included in the box. You're kind of stuck with Android right out of the box. But if you want to use, Windows, if you want to use your own computer, you have to purchase an accessory that connects down here. Battery life for this thing is pretty good. It takes about 2 hours to charge and lasts about 6 to 7 hours. And this is about the same as a smartphone running on Android. So it's going to last you about 4 movies, which is pretty good. If you're on a plane or something and you have Wi-Fi turned on or turned off, depending on that. It also features Bluetooth and a GPS. So you have some map applications and also Bluetooth applications fully functioning, which makes this product also pretty useful if you have, perhaps a remote control helicopter, a drone that you want to fly over, and you have a pair of cameras on there. You can use this device to control your drone, and also use the glasses to see them, which is pretty cool. But otherwise, pretty mid of the road hardware. It's not gonna do the most intensive games, but it does browse the web. It does play Flash Elements. It does do YouTube videos pretty well. The glasses themselves comes bundled with the shade included. The shade can be removed or disconnected if you don't want to have a more immersive kind of experience with a pair of glasses. With these shades put on, they're more like a traditional set of head-mounted displays, in the sense that you can actually watch videos with more comfort and more darkness, like in a theater. But with them removed, they're kind of like a Google Glass, where you can actually see what's happening around you and experience things around you as you are moving through them. So it's kind of interesting. It has a more interesting twist to them. As you can see here, they are transparent. Now, the interesting thing about the displays here is that they are not traditional displays. Rather, they're not really displays at all, because they're actually a projector system on either side. You can see how the glasses are actually quite bulky. And the reason behind why the glasses are quite bulky is because there are actually 2 pico projectors built into this unit. There's 1 pico projector on the left-hand side and 1 on the right-hand side. And these tiny little projectors are projecting light through this and reflecting it through this angled glass, which kind of simulates the experience of a screen as you are watching it. The experience is like watching perhaps a 50 or 60-inch television screen at home, if you're sitting on your sofa. It is pretty immersive. The resolution is pretty good. It's not full HD, it's lower than 720p, but it's nevertheless pretty good. When you're watching side-by-side 3D video, the resolution is halved because of the 3D technology, and so that's when you start experiencing some more pixelation and less clarity in the image quality, but it still definitely is usable and a lot better than other devices we've tested, unless you count the Sony HMZ series. So overall, still pretty good experience in terms of video. However, because of the projector systems being on the sides, it makes this thing a lot larger than a traditional pair of head-mounted displays. Because, instead of having a LCD screen, like a real screen, they have to make room for a projector on either side. And this makes the product a little more clumsy, and despite the fact that it's marketed as being more portable, I have to say that it isn't very comfortable for walking around, especially if you have prescription glasses. It is still pretty comfortable to use on a plane, on the train, or in the car, but not as good for walking around with. Otherwise, you can see it's made out of this plastic material. It's pretty good. It's scratch resistant, and the nose pad here is very flexible and can be removed. It's very comfortable, so after you wear it, as long as you don't move around, they are pretty comfortable. The sides of the arms are cushioned nicely, so it provides a nice amount of pressure on your head, and it definitely feels pretty good. When wearing these glasses, I have to say that the best thing about them is the fact that they have this kind of transparent virtual reality sense, where if you're watching a, you know, a video, it looks like it's hovering in front of you, which is kind of nice. And you can also interact with everything around you. So if you forget the controls on the control pad, you can still put it in front of your eyes and you can still see what's happening because you can still see the buttons in front of you. So it's kind of nice. And because you can still see what's happening in front of you, they produce less eye strain than on competing head-mounted displays. So whereas if I wore the Sony HMZ series for about 2 hours, I would get some eye strain. With these, I can probably wear them for about 3 or 4 hours, and I still wouldn't have an issue with my eyes hurting because I can still see, you know, everything from far away to close up again. So it's kind of nice. So certainly a good trick on the eyes. On other side of the product, we have access to two pre-installed headsets, and these are okay headsets. They're not the greatest, but they're not the worst either. And because of the Dolby surround sound, it provides very, very good audio quality. Indeed, one of the best audio qualities we've tested on a head-mounted display. And they have 3D experience, they have depth. If you're playing a YouTube video, they even sound good. So it's one element of these that really was quite blowing for me. It's probably not because the headphones are that great, but because of the sound quality in terms of the audio software is really that good. So we are excited about that. On the side of the cable that connects to the glasses, there's also a click key that allows you to dim and turn the screen on and off. It's a nice button to have, and it's a nice feature to build into the device, and we are excited to see that in place. Simply connect the device to the actual Android counterpart, power the device on, and you are ready to go. Again, you don't have access to Google Marketplace, but it's not that huge of a deal. You can still watch videos. There is still Flash, so you can still browse the web and see, loading video and streaming video. You can go to Hulu.com and watch videos that way instead of using the app. So it does support all those functions. Streaming video is actually surprisingly good. The Wi-Fi reception is very strong, and even if we were kind of a few feet away or a few meters away, actually, from another point in the building, another level in the building, we still had a very strong reception, and we could still watch YouTube videos and Hulu videos without any stuttering. We can also scrub between them quite nicely. The other option that you have for watching video is to put it into a micro SD card and sideload it, and then watch it in the gallery, and it works equally as well. Again, 3D formats is side by side. You can find thousands of side by side 3D videos in YouTube, and all of them work flawlessly and provide a very detailed experience. The 3D experience is one of the main selling points of this pair of head-mounted displays. I have to say that they are one of the best I've tested, and they are on par with the Sony HMZ as far as 3D is considered. And the reason behind why head-mounted displays tend to have better 3D experiences than on a traditional 3D TV is because, if you think about it, there's actually two screens, and so the 3D sense comes out a little bit easier. And in that department, it provides more depth, it provides less crosstalk, it provides a more detailed experience, you really feel it when you're having something in 3D move across the screen. It's kind of like an IMAX experience, and it's one of the most impressive aspects of these pair of glasses. As you can see here, you could kind of see the Android experience being loaded and run. Something interesting about the Android part is that instead of, again, kind of tapping once and having things, you know, expect them to move by tapping, you have to kind of press on it for a few seconds and then drag your fingers up and down to select on different applications. So for example, if I wanted to scroll up and down a list, instead of having the device differentiate between having a cursor appear on screen and actually scrolling, would be to tap a few seconds and then use scrolling by kinetically dragging your fingers along. And it works pretty well. The modified Android UI is pretty easy to use. You simply slide left and right between different programs, and web browsing was a pretty easy to use affair. And I can also, again, connect it to Bluetooth cameras like a drone, and that worked pretty well as well. So overall, it's definitely a pretty good experience. As far as watching video is considered, it's not as good as the Sony HMZ, but it's not bad at all. You can see how Android does fully load on here, and you can see how the screen is very, very bright. So even in direct sunlight, you still have access to everything, and you can actually still see everything as well. So it's a pretty impressive, you know, aspect of these glasses is that the brightness is very, 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 very good. You can see we have the Android kind of logo here, and everything is still working. And it's pretty impressive as far as the projector technology being clear enough to display all of these elements and still having you be able to access these elements as well. Now, of course, there are a few downsides to these pair of glasses, one being the fact that the simulated experience of 80 inches, I think, is not big enough for watching video alone. So if you're watching just if you're looking for just a video head-mounted display, I would still go with either the Oculus Rift or the Sony HMZ, just because those glasses offer a larger screen experience. But if you want a transparent device that merges kind of the best of both worlds of a head-mounted display and a virtual reality headset like a Google Glass, I think this is one of the better options to get. At $800, it's quite a investment to pick one of these up, especially because they are bulky and the Android counterpart has some flaws. But if you are looking for something that is kind of merges between the lines between transparency and a full-on head-mounted display, this is one of the only options out there. Generation 2 of the Epson Movie Aerios are lighter, and they provide, you know, it's easier to move around with them. And in addition, there's also access to a camera and an accelerometer, which are two features that are lacking on this current model. So in order to connect to a camera, again, you have to do that by yourself via Bluetooth. There isn't one built in, like on Google Glass, and there isn't an accelerometer, so you can't tilt your way around through games, unfortunately. But that's just one detail to note. As far as just watching regular 2D content, it still is fairly crisp, despite not being full HD. And again, if I'm typing up something on my computer while I'm wearing these glasses, it feels like the screen is hovering kind of before my eyes a few feet away, and then the computer screen is a few feet deeper in, so it's kind of like part of the background. So there is kind of this depth difference between what you're seeing in real life and what's on the virtual screen. It's kind of trippy the first time you try them on. So these are definitely cool. They definitely have a you know, market and have a place for people to check out, especially for early adopters out there. They have a lot more application because of their portability and the fact that the resolution is actually pretty decent as well. But again, they are niched in a sense, because if you want just a pure video experience, the Sony HMZ offers better video experience. It has a 450-inch screen versus an 80-inch screen, and so the obvious choice would be that. But if you're looking for, you know, a pure virtual reality experience, the Google Glass arguably has a lighter design that's more portable for day-to-day usage. You know, for gaming, you might want to look at Oculus Rift, because it's offers an accelerometer, which might be more beneficial in terms of head tracking and head tilting. But if you want to combine all of those three elements into one thing, perhaps the Epson Movie Aerio doesn't do one thing the best, but it is a jack of all trades. It combines the elements from all three and merges something that might be cool for a first-time consumer to check out and decide on what element they like the best, so they can purchase a more specialized device in the future. Anyways, we're excited to see this product out on the market, and there is still a lot of refining, and it's still pretty rough around the edges for Epson to do, and Generation 2 is already light years better than this in terms of comfort, even though the feature set is largely unchanged. But it still is a pretty exciting device to take a closer look at, and we definitely applaud Epson for their efforts on this cutting-edge tech gizmo product. And if you look at it, I guess $800, it's expensive on paper, but if you look at a cutting-edge smartphone, you look at an HTC One, you look at an iPhone 6 Plus, those devices are going to run you $600, $700 as well. So the price leap really isn't that huge. It's only because these are a pair of glasses instead of something more traditional like a cell phone that people kind of talk and say, oh, these are expensive. But if you put those into perspective, this is like an Android phone with the display being a pair of glasses. So the cost does make a little bit more sense in that department. So definitely something interesting to keep an eye out in the future, no pun intended. And you can check out more information about this device on our official review on our website at OS Reviews. But that's about it for this full review here at OS and VTXReviews.com, and also our brother site at OS Tech News. This has been our video review of the Epson Movie Aerio BT100 transparent head-mounted displays with Google Android installed as the operating system and Pico projectors as how the screen themselves work. Thanks for watching.